Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Doesn't matter what time of night or day, I'm still just as happy that you stopped by the channel. Thank you ever so much, all of you. There's more and more of you, too. On Medium alone, I'm up to about 460 followers now. Subscribers. They're not just followers, but subscribers. There is a difference, as you know. This is my latest installment on my ongoing biblical study series on the writings of the Apostle Paul. Currently, I'm in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, part 1, verses 1 through 16. Now, you are about to hear or view an excerpt from my faith-based educational book series. This is a Social Gospel Teaching Series, Volume 3, The Apostle Paul, by Reverend Paul J. Bern. That's yours truly. Copyright 2022, all rights reserved. Just to let you know. You can order the book on Gumroad from greatestservant.gumroad.com. You can buy it on Amazon Kindle by logging on to Amazon.com. From the drop-down menu, you select Kindle. And from there, you just type in the author's name, myself, Reverend Paul J. Bern. That's Bern with an E, by the way. Spelled with an E. Okay. So, for this week's biblical teaching series on the writings of the Apostle Paul, I will be continuing to focus on the promotion of Jesus Christ and his agenda, which is to reach out across the web and save as many souls through this little online church. Since I'm in my 60s and a disabled retiree, I can't go out and preach in churches or on the streets, as I don't have a car. But that saves me about $15,000 a year, which is how I can live on a fixed income. I'm not rich, but at least I'm not dirt poor either. I'm somewhere in between the two. I am personally bound and determined to get the message of eternal salvation of the souls of those persons on the internet who would normally not be found in traditional churches or their respective denominations. We all have so little time left before his return, which is why the message I am passing along today has such urgency. First subtitle, Rising Up Against Evil. The world, as we have known it, is dying from rampant pollution, pointless wars that have no end, overpopulation, potentially catastrophic climate change, and the overuse and mismanagement of natural resources. And so it is time for all of us to get our minds off of all the negative forces that make up our dying world and to begin to focus and engage with the forces of good. Mm-hmm. In so doing, the best way to begin to do this is to focus our hearts and minds on Jesus Christ, whose forever risen spirit causes us to rise up and stand against the forces of evil. That brings me to the topic of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, which delves into what is fitting and proper in the course of worshiping Christ, who is the world's only remaining hope. as I stated, this is the first of a two-part series we're going to be doing here. And so, I want to talk about faith in Jesus being serious business. I'm going to skim through the first 13 verses of chapter 11. Without much comment, due to some rather antiquated concepts about dress and personal grooming taught from a first century perspective. The most important is verse 1, which simply says, and I quote, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ," close quote. And this is timeless advice any way you look at it. We learn to follow the example of Christ by reading His Word and putting it into practice. And this should be an ongoing practice for everyone, because faith in Jesus is serious business, especially in a world where we are surrounded by horrific evil and cunning deceit. One of the things that faith in Jesus means is that there is gender equality under Christ. That's right, gender equality. Paul then writes in verse 3, "Now I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God," close quote. Although these values were very relevant when the Apostle Paul first wrote them 2,000 years ago, the part that says the head of every woman is man is no longer true in today's world. Modern values dictate that men and women are equals and that there is parity between the two genders. Such thinking as this would have been considered heretical in Paul's time, and anyone convicted of heresy always got the death penalty. Many religious people are abusers. Jesus never was. To elaborate, I grew up in a household where the father totally dominated everything and everybody else, both inside and outside the marriage and the family. The end result was a dysfunctional family that was ruled by fear and intimidation instead of by love and unity, as it should have been. In short, the relationship between the father and the other family members, including the wife, was abusive. Abusiveness and domestic violence, such as what I experienced when I was growing up, simply have no place in any modern household, and that is doubly true for a Christian household. Regardless of church membership or denomination. And so, I have seen this precept misused by religious people over and over again. You know, spare the rod and spoil the child, which gives them free license to just beat the heck out of us, usually with a belt, in my case. Now, let's contrast all these things with the controversies of the Apostle Paul. Jesus does not rule over us by domination and control. He does so out of love, grace, and mercy, as it is written, "Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy." Matthew chapter 5, verse 5, I believe. Matthew chapter 5, right there in those first 5 verses. The remainder of these first 13 verses is where Paul the Apostle writes, mainly from his own viewpoint, about the type of dress, right down to the length and style of the believer's hair. Very seldom will you hear me or see me disagree with anything in the Bible, but this is one of those rare exceptions. Paul the Apostle even got into whether or not people should cover their heads during prayers, as if that still matters. Today, some men and women wear hats to church, others don't. But we're all still worshiping the same Christ, and that's all that really matters. Maintaining a Christian set of values has nothing to do with how we dress. It is common to see me in church wearing business casual clothes. And I play the keyboard. I'm one of the musicians. I find it most unfortunate that some churches use these verses in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 as an excuse to dress up like they were going to a fashion show instead of a house of worship. I have been in churches where men and women alike were wearing literally thousands of dollars in high-end clothing and jewelry, and these types of people invariably sneer at those who can't afford to dress as they do. Remember what Jesus said when he was teaching in the temple in Jerusalem, and I paraphrase, "It matters a lot more," Jesus said, "what is on the inside of a believer than what is on the outside." External appearances don't count very much in the church of the last days before his return. God is far more interested in the state of our souls than in the state of our wardrobe. But that was the way of things in the first century in the early church. The Apostle Paul seems to at least attempt to clarify this when he wrote in verses 11 and 12, "For in the Lord, however, woman is not independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. For as woman came from man, so also man is born of woman. But everything comes from God." In the following verse, Paul further clarifies, "Judge for yourselves. Is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not the very nature of things teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace to him? But that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory. For long hair is given to her as a covering." Continuing in verse 16, "If anybody wants to be contentious about this, we have no other practice, nor do the churches of God." This was written 2,000 years ago, though. It's a completely different world now. And people generally don't judge other people by the way they're dressed. Or for that matter, how poorly they're dressed. Or they shouldn't be. This is all on us, people. It's all on us. And so, my, have times have changed. How times have changed, pardon me. It is difficult to tell whether Paul is offering this as a continuation of his train of thought in the previous verses, or that it is a caveat for the same. Customs for dress and personal care are radically different today than they were back in the first century, AD. In today's world, there is far more freedom of expression than there was back then. Verse 16 is particularly telling with respect to the mores and customs of centuries ago. Personally, I do not believe that long-haired men or the short-haired women will get sent to hell for their hairstyles any more than I believe people who don't listen to religious music will be condemned for their musical tastes. I happen to wear a ponytail, as you can see, okay? And this believer and follower of Christ is not going to hell either. I rebuke that thought, Satan, in the name of Jesus. I rebuke that in his holy name. Get it out of here. Get out from in between our ears right now. By the power and the authority invested in me by the Lord Jesus Christ as his entrusted servant. And so, don't miss part two. That'll be the very next video right down there in your listing. All I do is for the benefit of others. It is at this point where we are near the middle of this week's lesson, and I think this would be a good place to pause for the sake of brevity. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 has 34 verses in it. So there is no way that I could do justice to this chapter by cramming it all into one lesson. So everyone please be sure and return at the same time next week if you're on the blog, or next video if you're on YouTube, for part two of this installment of the Social Gospel Learning series. Until then, everyone take good care. Everybody, nothing but well wishes to all and goodwill to all men and women. Amen. That concludes today's ongoing biblical study series. Normally, at the end of the service, they pass around a collection plate to take up an offering. Of course, I'm online, so I can't do that, nor have I invested in a collection plate. But, hey, let's face it, we do need donations, if at all possible. We're already a registered nonprofit on PayPal and on Stripe.com. We'll be adding more as time goes on, but that's going to be all for right now. You can, another way you can help support this ministry is by subscribing to our blog, the Social Gospel blog, or the Social Gospel channel. The subscription, the paid subscription, is either $5 a month or $50 a year. That works out to about 16 cents a day. Not much. Not much at all. If you can. Or, if you would like to send us a donation instead, the instructions for doing so, including the email address to donate on PayPal, can be found in the comments section at the bottom, just below your screen there. If you prefer to mail us a check, the mailing address is 879 Rock Street, R-O-C-K, number 104, Atlanta, Georgia, 30314. That will be your zip. Okay. Don't forget to give me a like and a share and a subscribe. The YouTube subscription is free. I put out a minimum of 2 videos a week, sometimes 3, if I could find the time to do so. So, y'all stick with me. I appreciate you coming by today. I thank you that you've watched all the way to the very end of the video. As of now, you can give me a like, a share or 2, and a subscribe. Don't forget to subscribe. And I want to, before I go, I just want to thank everybody for the privilege of your time. You're all so very much appreciated. And having run out of things to say, at least for this time around, everybody be blessed. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.